Welcome to Conversations with Barbara. I'm Barbara Canalopoulos, and my guest today is Betsy Gladfelter, who's here to fill us in on the details of the next stage of the Coonamessett River Restoration Project and to tell us more about what has already happened. So thank you so much for coming to the program and talking about this enormous and wonderful project.
Well, so thank you for having me.
Yes. Now, we've come a long way. This is certainly great progress has been made, and you're looking forward to the whole other stage. Can you bring us up to date on what's been happening with the restoration project?
Okay. Well, let's just go back to when the project, as we're doing it, started, which was around 2010. And I like to use a phrase that a friend of mine uses about planting in Cape Cod. The first year, the plant sleeps. The second year, it creeps. The third year, it leaps. Well, in this case, we went from 2009 to about 2016 in the 2009 to maybe 2015 in the sleep phase. And then we began creeping. And then starting in October 2017, we began phase one, and we completed that in about 4 months. So phase one is completed, and I'll explain what we do in these phases. And phase two will go out to bid in a couple of weeks.
So are we going to then be in the, run phase, the galloping?
Oh, we're in the galloping phase right now. We're holding on,
yeah.
We're holding the reins tight.
Yeah, that's great. It's just so exciting. And the situation as it is right now?
So I just want to back up a little bit and say that the Coonamessett River itself, which we can see in the first slide, runs from Coonamessett Pond 5 miles to the ocean, and the last 2 miles is through a Great Pond. And the project itself is the lower Coonamessett River Restoration Area, which is about a mile of three cranberry cells that just to the north of John Parker Road, where it crosses those cranberry areas, former cranberry areas, and then for 3/4 of a mile to the south of there. So the phase one is, and you'll see a picture a little later on, phase one we started getting grants for that in 2010. And I just want to point out, you'll see at the end, there are about 30 partners, but two very critical partners to this project were an organization called the Coonamessett River Trust, which started doing studies on the river in the early 2000s, and since 2004 have done river counts. Many volunteers have helped with that, herring counts. And then for the last 4 years have tagged herring. So not only do we know how many herring are there, but you can answer questions like, how long does it take a herring, or what's the quickest a herring can get up to Coonamessett Pond where they lay their eggs? What effect do the barriers have on that migration? Things like that. And one of the other things is they've been able to determine that of the herring that are coming up, 10% go up to Flax Pond, take a right, and then the rest of them head up towards the Coonamessett.
So is it that community members, volunteers were collecting data?
Correct.
At this time, how? So
correct.
There was lots of community involvement.
Absolutely, and so there's a lot of community involvement, and they're also responsible for monitoring, the two things that I just mentioned, but they also do plant monitoring. How's that changing over time? They're doing other water quality, nitrogen measurements, and so forth. And that monitoring, it's all volunteer time.
Oh, wonderful.
But it's absolutely a requirement of the federal grants. But the federal grants won't pay for any of that. So we're very lucky to have a group of people. And some, but not all, of those people work in the scientific institutions mm-hmm. out of Woods Hole.
Right.
The other critical organization is the 300 Committee, starting about 15 years ago. Beth Schwartzman, in fact, mm-hmm. said, we should buy up as much as possible. It's critical to have a buffer to the river. So the river restoration, all that area is Town of Falmouth conservation land. Mm-hmm. But going up the river, some is Town of Falmouth conservation land, and the 300 Committee has purchased critical areas along. So except for one very small area, the entire river from Coonamessett Pond to Dexter's Mill Crossing is protected conservation land. And that's critical. Mm-hmm. And critical to the success of getting these grants mm-hmm. is this community participation.
Now, for viewers who maybe are new to Falmouth, they may be, and we have people who are moving here all the time, they may not understand that the bogs have been, cranberry bogs have been abandoned.
Early when it was
very well known that the damage to the environment had been made.
Right. Well, it's interesting because sometimes people's memories only go back so far, but if we look at the next slide, we can look at four pictures there. The one on the left is actually a picture of the river by Riverbend, but that has returned to a wild river. The river itself, and I should point this out, all of these rivers, including the Chiles that Gary was talking about a few weeks ago, these rivers are in very low gradient valleys. So between the ocean and Coonamessett Pond, which is 5 miles, Coonamessett Pond's only a little over 30 feet. And unlike the river that you think of when you're in fourth grade or whenever you learn about rivers, it doesn't flow out of a lake down with surface waters. The river itself is fed by underground springs all the way along. So further up the river, like the picture of the Wild River, mm-hmm. is the flow there is less than you find down in the river, in the part of the river that we're restoring right now, where many more springs have made it the volume much greater. But the other thing this shows is the picture, the map on the left is from 1893, and it shows a time just prior to the area being turned into cranberry bogs. But for 200 years, the very first mill, the very first blockage of a river in Falmouth was on the Coonamessett, and it was by Philip Dexter in 1700.
Oh, yeah, Dexter's Mill.
And now that the dam is gone there and we have a boardwalk, we've called it Dexter's Mill Crossing.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah.
A tribute to history.
Tribute to history. Right. And behind that, the lake behind that was called Factory Pond. And then where you have John Parker Road there in yellow, where it crosses mm-hmm. the valley, that was another mill. And the lake behind that was called Parker's Pond. For 200 years, this lower part of the river that we're restoring was covered with mill ponds. And then in the late 1800s, and there's a series of economic changes in the town, mm-hmm. including that the train came down, so you could bring products very quickly up to Boston. But these areas were turned into cranberry bogs. Mm-hmm. And cranberry bogs have been farmed commercially since the early 1800s. Dennis was the first commercial mm-hmm. cranberry farm. And they learned, and we were talking about this earlier, mm-hmm. they learned it was this first bog was near the ocean, and there are sand dunes. and sand would blow onto the bog.
Yes, yes.
And they quickly were the, you know, early farmers and fishermen had to be good natural historians. And they very quickly realized that by accumulating that sand, the vines grew much better.
So they were being good farmers.
They were being good farmers, right. And so that became a normal practice. So anyway, to go back to that slide, in the 1941 picture, you can see the blue hatching all the way along the river valley were cranberry bogs. And so almost the entire valley, in fact, even to the south of the bog, the southernmost bog, from there to Great Pond was also cranberry bogs, but that was abandoned earlier than that.
Mm-hmm. Now, it just became not economically feasible to continue to grow cranberries. The pesticides were needed to be used, and I guess it was very expensive to try to grow cranberries organically. And of course, economic factors figured into market it seems to me the market for cranberries on Cape Cod had been pretty much taken over by other states. I'm thinking of Wisconsin.
Wisconsin, well, traditionally it was Massachusetts and New Jersey were the cranberry states. Mm. Massachusetts was the most. Massachusetts still grows a lot of cranberries, but many of the Massachusetts cranberries now, there's one major cooperative, and if you belong to that cooperative, you're still doing okay. If you don't belong to the cooperative, it's much more challenging.
Yes. So,
and the Division of Ecological Restoration, since you bring that up, right. Division of Ecological Restoration actually has a specific program now to work with landowners who have cranberry bogs if they would like to work and convert them back into natural wetlands. Because cranberry bogs were all grown in natural wetlands.
Yes, yes, they thrive. Cranberries thrive in wetlands.
So there's a project that is, you know, that step ahead of us, that we are ahead of the Childs River,
yes.
Called Tidmarsh up in Plymouth. And the sort of inspiration behind that project is a couple who are, they're professors at MIT, but they own very large cranberry bogs. But they started working with the Division of Ecological Restoration and with Audubon, and they have converted all that area back into natural wetlands. Mm.
It seems that some of the work on the Coonamessett restoration perhaps has been a learning experience for others.
It is. A little bit further on, I'll tell you some of the groups that come. And two of the groups are people who are involved in restoration projects.
Right.
And since you brought that up, there'll be the Association to Preserve Cape Cod is going to be leading or is organizing two hikes. I'll lead the hike for the Coonamessett. Gary Anderson will lead the hike for the Childs River. But next week is, so the third week of July, there'll be a hike at the Coonamessett because people can see what happens. This is 1 year after the first, 1 year after restoration. And then the next week, we'll go out to the Childs where they actually haven't started any construction.
Actually, and the public's invited, and we hope that we'll have quite a lot of people signing on to do that walk.
Right, the public's invited. What they have to do is look up the Association for the Preservation of Cape Cod website because they have to formally
sign up. It's online, you can sign up online.
Correct.
That's right, and I think that will probably be reported in the paper, but if they look up APCC, they will get the date.
Correct.
Good.
Correct.
So you have another slide then.
Yeah, so why are we doing this?
That's a good question.
Yeah. So in the next slide, we have sort of the three main goals. And the first is to establish a happy, can we have the next slide? to establish a healthy, self-sustaining wetland ecosystem. And, you know, not only are there commercially important fishes, including river herring, American eel, brook trout, and white perch, but there are many other wetland species. There are turtles and frogs and snakes and butterflies and lots of things and lots of plants. So that's obviously one goal.
Yeah.
A second goal that people don't think about as much is to increase coastal resiliency. And I have some slides further on. You'll see that not only the Coonamessett, but all these valleys that flow south in Falmouth that go into Vineyard Sound, if there's a hurricane and there's a storm surge, it provides space for that water to move up the valley. And also, if there's a big stormwater event, if we get, you know, 10 inches of rain overnight, there's the restored river will act as a sponge.
Excellent.
And will slow that down.
Ah, so it prevents flooding.
Right.
Great.
Right. And then the third main reason is that we're people, we're doing this, and this is not only an opportunity to learn about these processes, but to have recreation.
Yes, and yes. Wonderful places for walking and for observing and just for enjoying nature.
Right.
Right.
Right. And one of the things of a couple of months ago, I think now, the 300 Committee and I think Salt Pond Area Bird Sanctuaries sponsored a forum where they examined sort of the health effects of being in nature. I mean, I like to be in nature because I've done this all my life.
Yes, yes.
But I think other people might not realize, we're a pretty active community. I think a lot of people get out and walk.
Right.
But how important it is to be out there and look at the, you know, look at the natural world.
Yes, yes. Sunshine, the healthy effects of, healthful effects of sunshine.
Right.
On our skin.
Right.
Right.
So, you want to talk a little bit about the project?
Yes, yes, definitely. There's the, and we have the next slide.
Yeah, the next slide will show you that where phase one is done, that's in yellow. And if you look at the river through phase one, the river channel in phase one, you'll see it looks much more windy than further north that we haven't done yet. And that's because the river channel itself was reconstructed, and I'll show you a picture in a couple of minutes, how that's done. But eight bends were put into it, and there's a couple of things that this does. One is it provides more river habitat. The other is on the outsides of the bends, we have pools that we have wood that protects them. And so they're places for the fish to hide. Just to the north of it into phase two, you can see the river there is fairly straight and flat and it has a sandy bottom because it still has sand coming into it. And the herring that migrate in this river system migrate primarily in the dark. They do it early in the evening and they do it very early in the morning before it gets light. Because otherwise they get preyed on by birds.
Predators, yeah. Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so by making a longer river channel and by providing areas of slow water and areas where the water is rippling, it's adding not only more habitat, but more diverse habitat for the fish. And then the other thing, of course, is we took a lower dam down, and I'll show you a picture of that in a minute. So for phase two, which we're going to go out to bid in 2 weeks, we're going to be taking middle dam down. So that whole middle berm, and you just see the culvert where the fish go through, but that entire middle berm, which is about 500 feet long, will be removed. Then for John Parker Road, those are sections where it says Map B.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, they're deteriorating pipe culverts that go under it. And we're going to replace that with a large, basically it's going to look, it's defined by Mass DOT as a bridge. And then both middle and upper bogs on either side of the John Parker crossing, those areas will be restored in what I'll explain to you in a minute, is how we restored lower bog.
Now, I'm sort of struck before you move on to the next slide by how much specialized information has come into this. So I would imagine there have been hours and hours of consultation with various people with specialized knowledge of aspects of the whole project.
Absolutely. So sort of briefly, our team that I was talking to you about earlier consists of a river restoration specialist.
Yes.
And his company, it's Interfluve, his company does the plans, and you'll see a plan in a minute, and does the permitting for us. And as Gary has learned, I told him, the permitting takes much longer than you ever anticipated. Right.
That's Gary Anderson of the Falmouth Rod and Gun Club.
Correct. And because you're required to have federal permits, state permits, and local permits.
I see.
For this. But several of them.
Oh my God.
And each of those levels. So, I lost my train of thought there.
We were talking about the specialized knowledge.
Oh,
that
okay.
Has gone
so, Interfluve. So, Interfluve has this knowledge. Right. But for one of the things that the Coonamessett River Trust did was they, when they started gathering information, gathering data about the river, they applied to what became the Division of Ecological Restoration, because this was considered an important river, right, to become a priority river. So we have a project manager from Division of Ecological Restoration, that's Eric Ford. And prior to Eric, we had Beth Lambert, but Beth is now head of that division.
I see.
Okay, so beyond them, we have what we call the marine fish person and the freshwater fish person. That's Brad Chase and Steve Hurley.
Yeah.
So they work with us. And then here in town, we have our engineering department works closely with Interflow and helps, you know, advertise and do all the bid process and oversees the construction.
Right. It just seems very complex, but it's all been working. It's all come together. And
it is. I won't say that it doesn't take effort.
It just amazing, lots of effort. And yet, working together slowly but surely, things have been working out exactly as predicted.
Well, absolutely. And I have to say that from a personal perspective, It's been very enriching to work with all of these people.
Yes.
One of the slides sometimes I show is, at the end I'll show you who our partners are, but I'll put that slide up. Then the next slide I'll show is a collage of maybe 20 pictures of that I've taken out in the field of people from NOAA, people from Division of Ecological Restoration, people from Mass Environmental Trust who have visited the river. So I said, you see all these symbols, but behind those symbols are people.
Yes.
And behind, and that's what makes it work. And then how do those people get that way? And then I talk a little bit about the work, we work with the schools too.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, let's move on to the next slide.
Okay. So, and then this can be, how do you restore a river?
Right.
Well, you remove the river barriers. You remove the dams, you remove, and you use big equipment to do this. Mm. You remove 1 to 3 foot of sand, you construct these longer channels, and the outer part of the bend have these large trees, dead trees, and what you have there, you just see some root wads, but you actually have three layers of root wads, three layers of trees that form that bend. And then the vertical, people wonder what those vertical posts are. The vertical posts stabilize those horizontal pieces. Mm-hmm. And at the lower end of the river, where you'd expect, if there is a tidal surge, to have the most effect, those vertical and horizontal pieces are held together with stainless steel. So it's complex. And then you have, and then they anchor, an additional anchor is this, what's called FES, fabric encapsulated soil, that's actually pounded in place. And then we add some buffer plantings, and then we tie the whole river as much as possible into areas where there are strong cold water springs. There's springs all along, but where they're very strong, we make a channel to there. And that's to help the brook trout. This used to be a major stream for salter trout, sort of sea-run brook trout. And in the early 1900s, people came from Boston and New York. They would have a fishing vacation here.
Yes, yes.
Because this was such a prime fish. And now first of all, that fish disappeared from the river. And so Steve Hurley has reintroduced native brook trout.
I see.
And the goal is to have refuges, cold water refuges, in the lower part of the river so that eventually we'll establish a sea run population.
I see. And the temperature is critical for that particular
Absolutely.
Species.
Right.
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 Interesting. Let's move on to the next slide.
Yeah, so very quickly, the next slide shows us plans that we're going to be starting on soon. And just quickly to show you, the deeper pools are these outer bends. And you see the, like, pickup sticks. Those are logs that are at least 24 feet long. And then the cold water refuges are also anchored. And finally, we have the John Parker Road crossing. And if we could have the next slide. So to replace those deteriorating pipes, one of which is collapsed now, we'll have, basically, it'll look like a bridge. And just to show you how things change over time, the next slide. So
oh,
in
yes,
2005,
look.
The farming had stopped that year, or the year before that. May 2018 is when we finished phase one. And so from the crossing, you're looking up river. In July, you see in just a couple of months, you had a fair amount of growth. And as I said to you, the grassland that you see there comes from seeds that were buried for 200 years by mill ponds and 100 years by sand. And then
astounding.
Isn't that amazing?
That? Yes, it is.
And then October, you're beginning to see lovely fall colors.
Yes.
And the next one, what do we have next? Oh, this is just to show you. So the orange going up, those, don't worry about West Falmouth right now, but the orange going up each of those rivers shows what storm surge, where storm surge could reach in a major hurricane.
I see. Yes, you spoke about that earlier. That is, this is a help to that kind of possible flooding that could happen.
Right.
It acts as a sponge, you said.
Right. Right. And the plant communities are native plant communities, so they will restore quickly because there'll still be a continual seedbed. And it's because this is a cold water stream, it's felt that it will be much less affected by droughts and changes in air temperature.
Right. And since climate change is on everyone's mind, it's just wonderful to know that this is going to be one aspect of making our coast more resilient to help prevent damage from climate change.
Right. Well, so it'll help help present against storm damage, and it will also help maintain those natural resources.
Yeah. So that's definitely a plus.
Yeah. So The second part of this project is, as we could see from the history, there's a very rich human history on the Coonamessett River.
Yes.
So the town is working with the 300 committee on the Coonamessett Greenway Heritage Trail. And if we could have the next slide. You can see that the lower part of the river where it says Lower Loop Trail, we'll talk a little bit about that in a second, but from there, from the gateway to the Greenway to the pond, depending on which route you take, is 3.5 miles or more. So along that trail, at the gateway to the Greenway, we'll have a trailhead, and I'll show you what we'll have there in a minute. And basically, there'll be parking off John Parker Road, and then there'll be access for everyone, including people in wheelchairs, to get down to the river level. And then that lower loop trail will be entirely wheelchair accessible. And then along the river, along the trail, along the river, but all those stars along the river can be accessed by car, and we'll have interpretive signs.
Oh, isn't that wonderful? 11 interpretive stations of showing our cultural and natural history. What a classroom. This is really wonderful, wonderful both for young and old, for learning more about our resources and our history.
Yeah, it's very exciting and it's fun. I mean, I will mention Allison Leshen generously. You remember the films that were shown in town meeting.
Yes.
She did those films.
Really?
But she's been working with me and it's been really exciting. And I told her that my goal, especially with the ones on organisms, like we just did one on reptiles and amphibians, is to have people see some of the common ones, but to begin looking around, observing. What do we see? What plants do we see? What insects do we see? What flowers do we see?
Yes.
Well, there are many more than we can possibly put on the slide, but at least it'll get you thinking in those terms.
Yes, and visitors can come not just once, but many, many times to add to their own knowledge, not to mention how valuable it is for school children.
Right. So we're excited. So the next slide actually shows this lower loop trail, so the Dexter's Mill Crossing Boardwalk is already there. We're about to start in a couple of weeks. We'll be constructing Swift's Crossing. And then during this phase two construction, we'll be working on this gateway to the Greenway. And we're having final meetings with town officials on the design of that as well. So next, so this just gives you an idea. These are four of the panels we've finished.
I see.
This will be at the trailhead, and the themes of the panels are the ones that have to deal with geology and hydrology, and so we're talking about the evolution of the Cape, the geological evolution of the Cape. And then the next two themes are history and natural history, or history and ecology. And we've done this by a timeline. And so the top part of that panel goes by date, and we talk about the mill area, then we talk about the cranberry area, then we talk about restoration and the effects of restoration. And on the bottom, we talk about how this will affect the ecology of the river.
Now, this is extraordinary. We're not only going to have the river restored, but we have here lessons for our young people, for scientists, for others, for tourists who might come and learn not only about our own history, but a little bit of learning about the science, and then for other residents of other places that are looking at restoration projects.
Right.
This is sharing so much wonderful information.
And in fact, it's interesting because Beth from Division of Ecological Restoration said what she likes about this, and the last one we have is restoration, what we did and what stressors it relieved, stressors to the natural system. She said, in a few years from now, people aren't going to realize you did any work on the river. They're going to think this is a natural river. But it's so people can understand that a lot of time and effort went into this.
And rather than have the history of this project in a book on a shelf gathering dust, it's there for people to see all the time.
Right.
And to digest, because it's a lot of information.
It is. And actually, it's funny because we were talking about tours, and I was leading a tour helping Coonamessett River Trust about a month ago. They had a family day, and I met this couple. I was walking back to where I parked my car, and this guy said to me, "This is really great." He said, "When did this finish? About 10 years ago?" And I said, No. We finished this part a year ago.
Yeah.
So it's amazing.
It is.
So what else do we have?
Next slide.
So this just gives you some examples. The top left is the group from Tinmarsh. So we visit one another's restoration sites to learn more. You know, there's some similarities, but there are differences with each site.
Yes, right.
The next is the Conservation Commission on a field trip with Nick Nelson from Innerfluve early in the process, and he's explaining what's going to happen. The one on the right is I've been working for 3 years with the T-Ticket second graders. The second grade teachers have been great, and I get invited to come in and give a lecture.
Right,
and then Jane Baker and her high school students have worked with them to do projects.
The art class, yes.
Right. So that one is, they each did a Japanese kite flag, and they ran around and said, "Betsy, look at us, we're herrings, you know, schooling in the sea." They love the idea of schooling, fish schooling.
Yes.
And then down below that's the Mullenhall fourth grade. We took all the Falmouth fourth graders got to go to the river this year, and the T-Ticket second graders got to go, and we took a third grade group. But I've taken many trips for high school groups, even high schools from other states, high school groups, college groups. So already a lot of school kids have been looking. But over to the right, there are people more our age who are out on a 300 committee trip I took the picture, but Molly Cornell is leading a birding trip in the wintertime. So the river, there's something to see all the time at the river, and it's for all ages.
Yes, extraordinary, a treasure. And so we have another slide.
So just two more slides. So the next one is just another, this is that same series, but you're looking west across what was the dam, the lower dam and fish run. That was taken out and we put a boardwalk in, so that's May 2018. Mm-hmm. By June, you see a little bit of vegetation has come and it's a lot of people use it for dog walking. And the sign there, the Dexter's Mill sign, that panel of fish, that was done by T-Ticket second graders, and Jane Baker's class did the background.
Oh, how nice.
But I've been down there, and there have been families there, and the parent will say to me, "My daughter showed me which fish was hers," which is kind of fun.
Right.
And the last one, not only are there a lot of people involved, next slide.
Ah, yes, the collaborators.
Collaborators for this river. And so many of these are about half of these are on the slide that's down at the river now. But our new collaborators, in addition to NOAA, which has funded a big chunk of this project, and NIFWF, which is over to the right, but we have new federal collaborators the U.S. Department of Interior Disaster Relief Appropriations Act, the Hurricane Sandy money. And then we have the state program that's Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program that's looking for resiliency, natural resource restoration. And then we have the U.S. Department of Agriculture Natural Resources Conservation Service, and their funds will go specifically to replace the culvert at John Parker Road. And then all those other Coonamessett River Trust and the 300 Committee, and then various groups who have contributed. Down in the right-hand corner, Tie and Bond and Interfluve and Sumco. And I left off there, but there should be Stimson are all work with us as designers and contractors. So it's a big group. It's definitely a collaborative effort.
Yes.
And it's a great group of people to work with.
Yes, I can see that. And I can see that the kind of expert knowledge that the various groups bring to the project has been critical. And of course, the funding. I don't know if there's been a summing up of that, but certainly has been an expensive
I can tell you
project.
Just the grant funds has been $3.9 million for this project.
Right.
And not counting the trail.
Yeah.
This is just for the river restoration.
Really?
And then, but you always need matching funds.
Mm-hmm.
So I, again, want to reach out to Coonamessett River Trust, who have put thousands of hours of volunteer time.
Yeah.
And also to many people in the town of Falmouth who support this project. I mean, this is a construction project, so it goes mm-hmm. through the DPW.
Right.
But the accounting department has to deal with
right.
the funds.
Seems like a wonderful example of public-private collaboration.
It is. Well, most of the funds are public, but they're federal.
Right. Yes. Yeah, they're federal.
Yeah.
Federal, yes. And with municipal support and certainly participation.
Right. But there are some private. There are a couple of companies
good.
That in town who have contributed to the projects. And if anyone who might be interested in contributing as we continue, I'd be happy to explain to them how it can be done. I can't take money. I work for the town.
Yes.
But people can. We do have a special fund that, for instance, the Bride and Gun Club mm-hmm. gave a donation,
mm-hmm.
and we can put that towards
right
activities.
Well, that's good for organizations in Falmouth and elsewhere to know about. So perhaps people can email.
Certainly, yeah, that same address.
Yes, email the conservation.
Yeah.
Right. Excellent. And I think that email will be put on the screen for viewers. Well, Betsy, I think certainly personally and on behalf of residents of Falmouth, I just can't thank you enough for your efforts there. Obviously, this is a labor of love.
It is. I've been fortunate in being able to travel in natural areas all over the world.
Right.
And my husband was an avid bird watcher.
Yeah. Yes.
And it's a privilege to be able to be part of a project like this.
Yeah. And to see it to its final.
It is. I'm hanging in there.
Yes.
Even though I threatened to stop once there was a sea run brook trout.
Ah. Yeah. That's not the culmination. What do you see as the rest of the timeline?
Well, this project will be completed a year from now. Both projects, both the restoration and the trail.
Mm-hmm.
But there's always more work to be done. You know, further up river, there are areas, and I will say our Chuck Martinson, our herring
mm-hmm.
warden.
Mm-hmm.
And his team have done a wonderful job, and in the past too, but maintaining herring passage in sometimes very challenging conditions. And I know they, well, I've taken some hikes with some of the federal funders and our state biologist, fisheries biologist, but there are things that can be done. But I think I'm ready to pass the torch on to someone else to lead that effort.
I see. I wonder if there'll always be volunteer opportunities for, say, maintenance, for oversight, for observations.
Absolutely.
I would think so.
Let me point that out. So the town of Falmouth obviously helps us with the maintenance, but we could, you know, work days, there will be work days coming up, mm-hmm. and we would certainly welcome people to do that. The 300 committee has a stewardship program, and so they actually help a lot, and they also help organize some of these work days. And the Coonamessett River Trust, if people are interested in becoming fish counters or working on the tagging program, they also love to have volunteers.
Lots of opportunities then for volunteers.
Right, and if people are interested, they can write to me and I'll pass their names
great.
On.
Great, that's excellent.
But that will continue because this will be a great asset for the town, but the town, and I don't doubt that this will happen, but the town will have to continue to, you know, take care of their assets.
Yes. As we do with all of our resources. They,
absolutely.
Right. You know, we very often, people talk about after forest fires, nature renews itself. But nature needs a nudge, more than a nudge. Nature needs our help to renew itself, particularly after there has been some damage done.
Major perturbations.
Yes.
Yeah. So what happened, you know, there are parts of the river, especially further north from this area, that, like the area by Riverbend, which is part of the greenway that the 300 committee owns that land, but that part of the river was also, you saw that map, that was also with cranberries. But a couple of things. One is the water flow there, you know, the river's a lot smaller there. And the problems that growing cranberries had on that area has kind of flushed out a little bit in time. And this is true like of the quashnet too. So that's sort of healed itself, and probably further north, rather than concentrate, because this is the other thing, people assume sometimes that all these restoration, everybody agrees, but there are wetland biologists who have certain goals, and there are fisheries biologists who have goals.
Yes.
And sometimes you have to make a decision, is this better? So when you have these side streams, the question is, how deep do you make them? Mm-hmm. If you make them too deep, you're going to drain the water from the wetland, from the highland to either side. So you want to have it deep enough that it'll provide a passage for the fish, but not too deep that you're impacting the wetland restoration.
So it's that kind of... not a compromise, well, I suppose it is in a sense. It's trying to make sense for both needs.
Right. So, I mean, there, like just like anything else, it's not straightforward, and many of these decisions are site specific.
Yes, right. They're competing interests, but actually not competing when they're looked at carefully and weighed as for what is the best process.
Right. So you know, certainly the fish biologists and NOAA who's funding us, who it's habitat restoration for these fishes, have certain goals. And the wetlands biologists have other goals, but there can be a compromise that allow both of them to flourish well.
Right. So all together then we have just an amazing collaboration that has, it looks to me as if it's going to be completed with all of the things that we had hoped for in mm-hmm. place.
Absolutely.
Right, yeah, that's wonderful. I can't thank you enough for being here to tell us about this.
Well, thanks for the opportunity.
And we will hope that viewers will sign on to take part in the public walks that are scheduled for next week so they can see for themselves exactly everything that we've talked about today.
Right, and actually, so Russ Robbins, who's just been reappointed to Conservation Commission, was the one who said to me today, well, couldn't you lead some on Saturday? And I said, well, on Saturdays. And I said, well, yes, you know, I'm willing to if somebody reaches out to me. So we have a meeting tonight, and I'm going to suggest that he bring that up, and we decide sort of the best way to do it. So we will be advertising some Saturday walks.
Oh, excellent.
People.
So viewers who are interested and want to see what we've talked about today firsthand, we'll have that opportunity.
Right.
And
they're certainly welcome to visit on their own
yes.
at any time.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's lots to see. There's
yes.
birds and there's insects and there's turtles and there's
yes.
frogs and yeah. all kinds of interesting things.
Well, I think that's wonderful, and I thank you again very much for being here and telling us about this wonderful project.
Welcome.
Right. Thank you for viewing, and we'll see you again next time on Conversations with Barbara. I don't know where I'm...